everybody get in and you're gonna sing it. You're gonna sing that song.
It may look like I'm surrounded, I'm surrounded by
you. If you know what I'm about to teach today, you will know that you can write yourself into the spirit. This is a song for the now. It's a prophetic song. It's a declaration. You gotta speak with your mouth. It doesn't matter how many people around you. It doesn't matter what is formed against you. The Bible said, no weapon formed against you shall be able to prosper. They shall surely gather.
It may look like I'm surrounded by you.
No weapon formed against me, Lord.
It may look like
into the realms of the spirit. And 2 Kings chapter 6 For the sake of time, I'll just speak a little bit because this is not what I'm about to teach, but I don't know, perhaps God wants to strengthen someone. I'll just skip a little bit of some verses and then read from verse 9. The man of God sent word to the king of Israel, talking about Elisha, beware of passing that place because the Arameans are going down there. So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he told that he was on his guard in such places. This enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his officers, watch this, and demanded of them, tell me, which of us is on the side of the king of Israel? None of us, my lord. Because what happens is, Elisha was given the king of Israel privileged information. He was given an insight into what is about to happen. So before the king of Aram would conspire to come against them, the king of Israel has made a move. So he thought that his people, within his people were committing espionage. People were spying on them to tell the king of Israel. Because before the enemy planned against you, before the enemy set in a trap for you, he thought that people are telling you what is about to do against you. But he doesn't seem to realize that you serve the God who is all informed, the all-knowing God. So while the enemy is thinking that he wants to come around your money, God has already prepared something for you. God has already maneuvered you away. So the king of Aram started wondering. He said, call all the people. Let's ask a question. Who amongst our people is telling the king of Israel what we are about to do? Who amongst our people is telling these people what we're about to do? Because I thought I knocked her down. I thought I defeated him. I thought I locked him up in the corner. I thought I hedged him in. What's going on? Before we plan something against him, he's already found a way out. He's going somewhere else. We thought it was going to Spain. We sent all the enemy camped around Spain, waiting, you know, to dethrone, to defeat him, to destabilize him. And then we saw him in New York. What's going on? What's going on? We thought they were going this way, and then they went that way. But you serve a God. You serve a God that the Bible said is all knowing, it's all informed. He sits in the heavens and rules in the affairs of man. We serve a God who knows everything. The Bible says he knows the end before the beginning began. He's the all knowing God that set the foundations of the earth. We serve that God, my God. He said, this enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his officers and demanded of them, tell me, which of us is on the side of the king of Israel? None of us, my lord, the king, said one of his officers, but Elisha, the prophet, who is in Israel, tells the king, my God, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom. Elisha, the king, Elisha, the prophet, watch this. He tells the king of Israel the very word you speak in your bedroom. So while people, as some people are conspiring in your bedroom, thinking of how to put you down, to fire you, to put you in problem, in shame, God sees them in your bedroom and said, I've got to warn my child. I've got to tell my daughter. I've got to tell my son what is about to come. You must not even know when you make certain decisions. You must not even know when you make last minute changes, Matthew. All of a sudden, you changed your mind. You said, I'm not going that way. You changed your mind. You said, I'm not buying that property. I'm not investing in this business. I'm not traveling to this place. You Muslims don't even know the full details. Why are you making such decisions? Why are you here today? You Muslims don't even know. You bought a ticket to New York and found yourself in South Africa. You planned your trip from January that you will be in the Bahamas. Saw yourself dreaming on the beach, you know, relaxing, chilling. But when the time came, you felt the need. There was an urgency in your spirit. There was a longing, there was a desire in the inside of you saying, go to Africa. And you're like, I want to go to Africa. I want to be on the beach, the blue sand, the blue river, the white sand. I want to be there. But there was something on the inside of you that is moving you to say, no, Africa. Every place you go, Africa. Everywhere you go, your mind, every television station you tune, they are talking about Africa. Every conversation, before you know it, someone is saying, do you know Africa? You go to school, everybody is saying Africa. On your job, they're saying Africa. The emerging markets, the expanding territory. Everything around you is saying Africa, and then you go to Africa, not realizing that demons the body to sabotage you, to strangle you, to stifle your grace in the Bahamas, even though it looks beautiful. Nothing wrong with a place that the enemy planned to go there, because you spoke with your mouth and said, I'm going to go there, they're going to wait for you. That God who sees the bedroom of man, God who knows the conversation in secret. The Bible says he that sees in secret rewards openly. He knows the thoughts of man. He said, whilst you're still speaking, I already responded. He knows conversation in secret places. Listen, I don't need to hide the FBI. I don't need the CIA. I don't need the MI6. I need Jehovah God. I need El Shaddai. I need a great I am. I don't care what you say in secret places. He knows how to speak to me. He knows how to communicate to me. If I keep my ears open, he will tell me what to do. I will always be one step away from you. He's the God that made the king not to sleep. The Bible said on that night, Matthew, the king could not sleep. And he said, has anything been done for Mordecai? There is a reason why all of a sudden the king could not sleep. When it came to the time for David to favor and Mephibosheth, David came from battle. All of a sudden he said, has anything been done? Does anyone know anybody that lives in the house of David, of Saul? Anyone know anyone that lives there? All of a sudden, Mephibosheth did not do nothing physical to get there. Mordecai did not manipulate nothing. But when the time comes, God knows how to make people in authority restless for you. He knows how to make them to move on your behalf. He knows how to trouble the mind of person. You don't seem to understand there are people that God can implant in their heart to set up certain businesses because of an idea that is put on the inside of you. Because of an idea, a creative invention that God has put on the inside of you. Because of the gift of the anointing, the skill and the expertise that you have on the inside of you. God can stir somebody up to move all the way from South Coast and move to East Coast just because of you. Someone will have a need to buy your property in a place that you never even imagined before, because God sees a secret. Oh my God, that one song. So, verse 13, it said, go out. Go find out where he is. The king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. You want to capture a man? They've already told you that this man serves a God who can reveal what you're doing in your bedroom. Now you're conspiring with your people to go and find out on the way to catch him. Are you silly? Have you not imagined that over these years you've been trying to trap me, you've been trying to capture me, that somehow I scale over, even when my feet is broken, when my hands are broken, when it seems like there is nothing working for me, I seem to find a way out, I seem to be on top. Have you not learned your lesson that every pit you dug for me, I seem to walk past it? Have you not learned your lesson that every mess you poured on me seemed to make me grow? Have you not thought about it? That all the rubbish you put on me make my skin to glow? Have you not imagined that everything you seem to pour on me make me to shine? Have you not imagined that the chemicals you poured on me that should have destroyed me was what made my skin to be as bright like a diamond? Have you not learned your lesson? You are still blind. I'm always plotting against you. If I were God, get excited. Because God said to announce to you, Victoria, what have you done? God said to announce to you that there is something coming your way. It is coming as a result of the people that are plotting against you. He said, I'm working for you. And all things are working together for your good. Amen. He said, go and find where he is so I can capture him. The report came back. He is in Dothan. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. And listen, don't you think about this? One prophet, they sent chariots. They sent men of war. They sent a force. Now you keep wondering, how can small me be going through this big a problem? You keep asking questions. How comes me that looks so small, that look like nothing is working for me. Me that have not written nothing, that have not been on any billboard, that have not been on any major platform. Me that have not traveled the nations yet, don't have a television program. Me that no one knows about. How come all hell is broken loose against me? But God said to announce to you that you're in this house or watching online. God said to tell you that the thing that come against you is a reflection of what is on the inside of you. He said, I've put greatness in your inside. I've put mega on your inside. I've put a double-double on your inside. I've put a massive anointing on your inside. Hence, the enemies can't rest. The enemy's raging. You are looking at your physique, looking at your sales, looking at your place. And God said to tell you, the enemy's not responding to where you are. The enemy's not responding to who you look like. He is responding to who you truly are, who God has made you to be. God made you to be the head and not the tail. He put so much on the inside of you. I don't know what's running against you, but you better hurry up, because I can't wait for the manifestation of this breakthrough. The manifestation of my breakthrough is predicated on how quick the enemy responds. You don't hear me. You are praying for the enemy to stop. My God, not to have excited this Sunday morning. You are praying for the problem to stop. And God said, no. That is a wrong prayer. The quicker the enemy walks to attack you, the quicker the manifestation comes to you. Because the anointing that you want to see, the breakthrough you want to see, the mega business you want to see, the strategies you want to see, it'll come based on what the enemy does. Because the enemy don't know that God wants to use him to reveal him to you. God said, I've got to reveal myself. That I can't reveal myself. Light doesn't make no significance in a place of light. God said, I've got to do something. What do I need to use? What do I need to put engaged? When God wanted to show himself in Egypt, he hardened the heart of Pharaoh. He told them, tell Pharaoh to let them go. But then he hardened the heart of Pharaoh because he wanted to show himself. God said, I tell somebody, my God, Victoria. God said, I tell somebody that you're praying for all these problems, the sheaves, that I'm about to do something in your life. I will expedite it by the reason of the workings of the enemy, not the workings of the people that around you, that like you, that the workings of the enemy. God said, I tell you, I'm putting enemy force together. I'm putting challenges together. I'm putting demons together. I'm putting problems together. I'm putting fighters, haters, mockers together. Because the quicker they walk, the quicker I show up. The quicker they walk, the quicker I manifest. The quicker they come to you, the quicker I manifest. The quicker they come closer, I show myself. Woo! My God, they send a force for one man. Now you're wondering, why is everyone ganged up against you? Well, first of all, why is everyone fighting against only you, but everybody against you? Only you, everyone pointing fingers. Only you, all around you have a problem. Your money is not solid yet. Then is your marriage. Then is your mind. Then is your ministry. Only you, every part you look, you are hedged in. Victoria, I did not realize I was going to speak from 2 Chronicles 4 that we are pressed on every side. We are surrounded and battered. My God, my God. You alone, I'm sent against you. I don't know what this word is for, but if you're watching online, you're in this house, you better tap somebody. You better send it to someone. You better tell someone. You better come and listen to this word. because there is a prophetic word in the house for you. I did not intend a preacher. I intended to teach God's word in a gentle counselor. But God said, son, you can't be gentle. There is an urgency in the realms of the spirit. He said, there is war going on in the realms of the spirit. He said, I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded. It may look like I'm hedged in. It may look like I'm beclouded. It may look like I'm suppressed and oppressed. That I'm surrounded by you. They found him in Dothan. Verse 14. Then he sent horses and chariots and strong force. I can stay there all day. He didn't send weak force. He didn't send small force, Victoria. He did not send childish demons. The enemy planning against him are not jokers. They are equipped. They are first class PhD holding devils. They are devils that are so muscular and boisterous. You think I'm fit and strong? The enemy coming against you, Esther. They've got biceps as big as a house. They've got intellect. They're intelligent. The demons the enemy sent it to you. Because if a king is sending his forces to attack you, you must understand it's not a major sending them. It's not a general sending them. It's not just a sergeant sending them. If a king is going to deploy, he will deploy the best of forces. He will deploy the cream to the cream. The main expert, the people in the SEAL force, the selected force, he will make sure because his word must not fall to the ground. So the king will not send jokers for you, Elizabeth. The enemies that are coming against you, don't be fooled. They are sensible. They are intelligent. They are smart. They are creative. They are adventurous. They are skilled. They got strategies because they are sent from the king. So the enemy is coming against you. They know how to maneuver themselves around you. They know how to walk themselves around you. See, they've been trained on desert storm. They've been trained on ground attack. They've been trained on submerged attack. They know how to get to you. If you go this way, they understand you. They will study you and just to get to you. He sent them to look for Elijah. It didn't take them long. They came back and said, he's in Dothan. They know where you are. The enemy knows where you live. The enemy knows what you're doing. He understands your itinerary. He understands your schedule. He knows your job and your family. He understands how you operate. He knows where you go for lunch. He understands it because of an intelligent force will come against you. You must make sure they go ahead, send an advanced team to understand the territory. Just like before the Americans go to the Taliban, they send people ahead of time to spy, to do a mock-up attack. And then they practice and practice because when they heat, they want to heat on their knees. So the enemy is coming for you. He knows where you are. But wait a minute. I've got news for the enemy. That's not where the story ends. The story don't end for him knowing where you are. Then let's go a little further. My God. Oh, someone has touched heaven. Someone has touched heaven. So they went. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force. They went by night and surrounded the city. It may look like I'm surrounded. It may look like I'm surrounded. It looks like you're already defeated. As a matter of fact, when the people around you saw the enemy, they said, forget it. This man is done for. This woman is gone. Reputation destroyed. Her life will not rise again. His anointing is defeated. No one will affiliate with him again. Nobody will connect with her again. Her reputation is destroyed. Once you come out and say this, or he does this, we disconnect from them. We do not want to have fellowship with them. And when we do that, everything will break out of line for them. Her marriage, her money, her ministry, her mind, she's surrounded. Everything is falling apart, and that's not where the story ends. They came by night. The night time when it looks like nothing is working for you. The night time when there is no hope for release, when there is no hope for help. And the banks are closed. You know, when somebody said, I would have helped you. The banks are closed. I can't do anything in this night. I would have come, but it's too late to book a flight. Can't be there for you. Look, my heart is with you, but I can't physically be there for you. I would have loved to help you, that let's wait till money. So that is the time that the enemy sent his people to surround you. But there doesn't seem to be any help from anywhere. So they surrounded them by night. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Oh no! My Lord! What shall we do? The servant asked, the people around you already are afraid and perplexed. What shall we do? How can you help us? My God. Verse 15, when the servant of the Lord woke up, he saw that at his screen. Verse 16, this is what Elisha said. You see, the Bible said, they that know their God shall be strong and do exploit. They are like Mount Zion and shall never move. Look at what the man of God said, verse 16. 2 Kings 6, we're still reading. It said, don't be afraid. The prophet answered, those who are with us are more than those who are with them. See, the servant thought he was speaking in parables because literally, there is no one for you. Look around you. There is no one actually for you. There is no one working for you. There is nothing. No one is speaking for you. No one is fighting for you. Physically, look around yourself. Is there anybody that wants to connect, affiliate, and help and support you and lift you up? Literally, there was no one. And you're telling me that those for us are more than those against us? My God, this guy didn't understand. And Elisha prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. He was looking, but he was not seeing. See, that is why the Bible said that we don't walk by flesh. We don't fix our eyes on the things that are seen. For the things that are seen are temporal, subject to change. But the things that are not seen are eternal. So open his eyes that he may see. So the Lord opened the servant's eyes and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Even if you will see what God has put around him. It may look like you're surrounded, but you're surrounded by him. I don't understand. I thought earlier on when we read, he said, the chariots, the horses, and the strong forces surrounded the city. But I don't understand. How comes now Elisha is saying, there are angels, there are men of war, and all of that from God surrounding them? So then you can understand what Victoria was singing in Esther. And it looks like I'm surrounded. But I'm telling you, I'm surrounded. Yes, I'm surrounded. There's no doubt that I'm surrounded. I am definitely surrounded. So, but what the enemy don't seem to understand is, he thought when I say I'm surrounded, I'm acknowledging the fact that he is overpowering me. He is winning. But he doesn't seem to understand that anytime I say that, I'm acknowledging the fact that Jehovah and his men of war have surrounded me. As the enemy came down toward him, Elisha prayed to the Lord, strike this army with blindness. So he struck them with blindness as Elisha had asked. My God. I just don't want to go further, but the enemy is going to go blind for you. I tell you, I'm not joking about this one. They will be looking, but they will not see you. Father, we declare in the name of Jesus that every enemy form that I've been sent against your people, in whatever way, Lord, that they've manifested or showed themselves or prayed to, Lord, that you will strike them with blindness. They will look, but they will not see. In the name of Jesus. They will not be able to identify your people. They will walk into a room, they will be asking your people, do you know of this man? They will come in the organization newly, they will not even ask your name. They will be speaking to you about the oppression they were sent to come and do against you. They will expose themselves with their own words. They will use their sword against themselves. In the name of Jesus. by themselves, they will conspire against themselves. The word says they will surely gather, but the gathering is not of you. That whosoever shall gather against your people shall fall. So Lord, I stand as your servant this afternoon. I declare, Lord, that as many that gather against your people, Lord, your gathering will not stand, your words will not hold ground, your confession will not manifest, their expectations will not come to pass. In the name of Jesus, we declare this day, God, that the enemy's walking will be useless for us, to our advantage, for our advantage, for our advancing, for our promotion, for our productivity, for our increase. In the name of Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. See, today I was going to speak on pressed, but already the worship took us into the word, and I did not have to touch my text. This is what God wanted us to hear, because it's the same word I was going to speak on, 2 Corinthians 4:8, that we are pressed on every side, and we're not in despair. The Message translation says we're surrounded and battered, but we're not demoralized. I was going to go into that, but I will go into next week by God's grace. But I believe that God wanted someone to hear that it may look like you're surrounded. Number fooled by people's beautiful smiling faces. Number fooled by the makeup and all their good looks. Number fooled by people that are afraid, trembling on the inside. Every morning that breaks, we are asking God questions, is it another day again? How am I going to fix this? Well, they come to church, number four, they pray, they intercede, they worship, they preach, they dance, they play instruments, they do all that, they walk in the church, ushers, protocol. They are very effective. Their suit is spot on. Hairdo fine. Fine, cotton palace style, like nothing is wrong with that. Number four, there are people that are asking questions every day. God, if I make it through one more day, I'll give you praise like I've never praised you before. If I survive another onslaught of the enemy, if I make it alive through the night, I'll bless you forever. Because they are troubled, hedged in, battered, hammered on every side, fought against from every side, beaten from every corner. The people that the men that speak for them, speaking against them, cast and don't even know it, spoken against, betrayed and denied, ostracized, and yet they are still going on. I want us to bow our heads and we pray. Father, Lord, I'm not ignorant of the devices of the enemy. Neither am I ignorant of the fact, oh God, that amongst your people, there are people, oh God, who are still asking questions and trembling and worried. There are mothers, there are fathers, excuse me, there are children, there are single people and married people, oh God, in this house and online, troubled, Lord, in their minds and in their hearts, asking questions that never go answered. Afraid to wake up just to face another day of trouble. Identified, Lord, their punishers. And those, Lord, that have held them captive. They don't have the strength to confront and comfort. Feel like the world is crumbling on them. Feel like all hell is broken loose against them. Feel like they are in between a hard place and a rock. Can't figure a way out of life. Every little thing that happened about them, their minds skip. Their blood pressure go up. They don't know how to believe. Nobody understands what they're dealing with. But Lord, we pray today, God, that you open their eyes to see that them that are for them are more than them that are against them. And it gives them the strength, Lord, to keep holding on. Lord, I pray this day, God, that you give them the grace to put your hands on the plow and never give, look back. That every passing day that comes, oh God, that will find a reason to live again. For your word said that there is hope for a tree that even when it is cut down to the ground, but just by the smell of water, that begin to board. I pray, God, that these ones will be like, Lord, those ones who have just smelled, Lord, a fresh release of water. The water of your word that will make them bored and not bend and not faint. The Lord, that they'll begin to blossom again. And in the midst of tears, they will find a reason of joy and glad. But just like the songwriter said, that ain't no need to worry, what a night is going to be. For it will be all over in the morning. Father, I declare this day, God, the strength be released on your people like never before. That grace, Lord, be manifest uniquely on them, oh God. Lord, that even if we don't know, need to know the details of what it goes for, you see, you know it, God. We bring them before you, God, and ask of your grace. Those watching online and those in this house, they will keep being strengthened and not faint. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Amen. Look at your neighbor and tell them, I'm surrounded by him.
I'm surrounded by him.
Something in mind. So he has said what he wanted to say. I was just a tool, a vessel to be used in that respect. So we thank God for him and thank for the grace of God and Victoria and Esther for bringing us to that point of understanding what God wanted to say, you know, today. So thank you so much. Pray that God continue to increase you all. Everyone in this house, God, increase you on every side, and your light will not go dim. You will not faint, not be weary. There you will go from grace to grace, from strength to strength. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.